So the final speaker of this session before the coffee break is Jesper Den Hartog, software engineer in the R&D department at the RIPE NCC. He works in cleaning, aggregating, and visualizing networking-related data sets and turning them into APIs. He is a core developer of RIPE Atlas and RIPE IP Map and works in the, as I said, RIPE NCC R&D department. Please could you welcome Jesper to the stage.
Hi. So I'm a software engineer in the R&D department of the RIPE NCC. I'm not going to tell you what the RIPE NCC is, because I think you all know. But in the R&D department, we make a few services, although we call it research and development, the most famous of which is probably Atlas. And I want to briefly go over some new stuff that we did recently that's not somewhat related to the Atlas, but different. So we also make RIPEstat, which hosts like basically all of the data sets we collect on our own and third parties data sets that we think are useful and data sets that cross the RR boundaries. So this is a point of confusion that I hear every once in a while, that like for lots of data like IRR data, we host data we can get our hands on, not only our own RAR collectors, but also the from the other RARs, and I think even RADB. One notable small feature, but significant, is that now you can see in the AS routing consistency widget, you can see RPKI ROAS. So this is our AS, which seems to be sort of fine. Again, you probably would be interested in valids, and invalids. So unknowns are at this point not so interesting. One note though, at this point in time, RPKI will of course do only origin validation and something around path length, maximum path length. But probably, hopefully in the future, this is sort of step up if the SPA proposal is going somewhere, which is basically validating BGP adjacencies, and then it gets interesting because then we can validate parts of the path. So this is our yeah. And then another thing is we for ages we've had the risk collectors. We have 21 of them. So we have basically route services that only collect data from people and organizations who are willing to peer with us at the locations. And we have one where you can remotely peer to. And for also for a long time, we had a, I think, demo.riz.live or something that would stream all of the announcements and withdrawals that the collectors see in real time. But it was sort of hidden and a sort of demo. But now this is an actual product. And there's a complete Labs article on labs.ripe.net. But what it amounts to is that we have a backend that gets all the data from the risk collectors and will emit it over WebSockets and over SSE, server-side events. So you could both write scripts for that. There's Python libraries, there's two or three Python libraries that will actually be able to ingress those, ingress the data, and you can do whatever you want with it. And of course, you can stream it into browsers. WebSockets are were made up in the browsers. So, if you want to have more information around it, please talk to me. I'll be most willing to help you out and to point you to the locations where you can use this stuff. Then there's RIPE IP Map. This is like now over a year old. Was the inception is like 5 years old. I will get back to that. Basically, what it does is, well, it tries to geolocate the core internet infrastructure. It consists of two interfaces, basically. One where you can look up IP addresses and you get back a list of locations. And the other one is it will try to visualize trace routes from the RIPE Atlas system. So active measurements that are done from the RIPE Atlas system. You can actually, on the measurements pages of RIPE Atlas, you can, if there are trace routes, you can have visualizations like this. I'll go back to that later on. Another thing is for 5 years now, we have been experimenting with the IXP Country Jedi, which tries to get information from the RIPE Atlas system by making active measurements within a country or within a region. from probe to probe in a matrix, in a full matrix, and see what kind of data we can arrive from that. We've made a new visualization around this, combine it with a new data set from APNIC that tries to estimate how many end users there are in a AS within a country. So that's a per country data set that hosts all the ASs that actually have end users in them. It's a controversial data set, by the way. There's large caveats around the way they collect this data and the way they correct it. But it's the only data set that we know of this type that does this kind of stuff. So if you know of a better data set that we can use, please let me know. I'll go into more detail later on. So the meat of this talk was we were asked the question in 2015. Emil Aben, our head of research, gave a talk here, which was basically the first country Jedi thing that he made. He made a special run of all the probes to all the probes in Sweden, and next to that, a run of all the probes in Sweden and Denmark combined to each other, and then see whether we could make out whether the traffic intended from probe to probe would stay within this region, or that it would go outside of the region, and some other stuff. So back then, our house style looked like this. I still like it, but hey. So back then, we had like, already more than 8,000 probes. And right now, we have more than 10,000 probes online at any given time. So we have way more probes, I don't know, 25,000 or something. But at any given time, you will see that there are at least 10,000 online. Of these 10,000, I think it said like we had 100 anchors in 2015. We now have more than 500 anchors, more than 100 of which are virtual anchors, which have been basically spun up in the last 6 weeks, I think. So there's a huge increase, so also if you want a virtual anchor, so this is basically an anchor, which is a hardware 19-inch thing that you can now run as a virtual device, basically on any virtualization platform. So if you're interested in that, please let me know. Emil set out the components that he was gonna use in IXP Country Jedi. And one thing is, he was going to use traceroutes. Traceroutes were pretty new to Atlas back then, and we still do that. Right now, we have much better visualization tools around this. My former colleague Massimo Candela made a visualization for traceroutes, a graph visualization, where you can see for a measurement how which routes you see, and where they join up, and how they evolve over time. So this particular one, you can see here, these are the probes on top, and they go to the same destinations, and they all seem to join here, which is probably an NE100 IP address, I guess. And there's these trees here, they end up at this node. And if you would go over time, you would see this change. Back then, Emil basically started with what was then called OpenIP Map, which is called now RIPE IP Map. A project to get the IP core internet infrastructure located basically by means of crowdsourcing. So he basically set up a database that anybody could enter IP address in where they knew the location of. And this has also been involved into a product right now that looks like this. You can, it has a UI where you can look up stuff. So Emil said that he had like 30K infrastructure IPs mapped out in 2015. Right now we have more than almost 200,000. And it evolved in a thing that has like multiple engines stacked on top of each other. The most important of which is not the crowdsourced engine, basically, but the thing that we call the single radius engine. I mean, if you have 10,000 probes online, that means that we have lots of probes in the vicinity of every IP address, basically. So what we do, we schedule, if people ask for a IP address and we don't have it already in the database, we schedule a measurement from the probes towards the destination, and then we kick out all measurements that take longer that give us back an RTT of more than 10 milliseconds. And then we look for the best one, and we come up with multiple circles, and we try to, by triangulation, come up with the location. There have been research around this by third parties that found our country on a country level we are 99.9 something correct, and on a city level we are the best data set around for non-end user IPs. This is still an ongoing work. Most notably, we don't have a very good reverse DNS engine right now. So one of the ways that researchers try to come up with IP addresses is looking at the host names and then figure out from there whether that is whether there's an actual location in there. Like big transit providers are known to have schemes for, you know, with using IADA codes or something like that. Qaeda has done extensive research around this, and they seem to have a really good engine, so we're still working to include that. Then IPMap has an API that you can query. So this features best in here, but you can leave that out. You will get only one IP address back, or if it's Anycast, you will get lots of IP addresses back. And you can also specify like partials, and then you will see the specification for each engine. So if you, for some reason, want to rule out one engine, or you want to see like why a particular engine returns a particular result, you can look it up there. And then about the interface. So we have already talked about this, right? We have the interface on IPMap-derived.net, which is just a sort of convenience thing where you can look up IP addresses. And then there's the thing within embedded within Atlas. If you go to a trace with measurement, you can actually see it on a map. And then the one in Atlas will give you much more information. It will basically visualize the complete trace route with the ASs and all the RTTs lined up, more of that information. And in this interface, you can also add locations, because here it says like add location. So if we don't know the locations and you do, you can actually directly in this interface, it would be here, you can change this stuff. I thought there was a... Yeah, so here you could change the location, and you would be able to just add a location. And you don't need to be logged in or anything or identify yourself right now. In the future versions, we will probably, if you can indicate by logging in, basically, that this prefix belongs to you. I cannot say that from registration services. I never know what you do with prefixes. You don't own them. You can use them. I don't know. You announce them. You can fill it out, and then it will be a sort of authoritative answer. Like the people that have this prefix allocated are saying that it is here. And you can also opt out of geolocation. If for some reason you don't want your prefixes geolocated, you can actually indicate there, like, don't do this. Then another thing is, this is not hard science in the sense that we can never be totally sure that something is anywhere. So we on the interface, we try to indicate what the sort of confidence around the actual score is. So there's stuff that we're pretty sure that's the actual location. So that would be this full circle. Like, yeah, we figured we have lots of engines that align on this location, and then there's stuff, yeah, this is sort of a wild guess. And also there would be, if people would only crowdsource stuff, it would also stay on the low side of things. That would, because we have no way of validating it, because if we would validate it, then it would immediately pop up here. If somebody crowdsources something and we can validate with active measurements that it's actually in the location, it will be there. So this, if there's only crowdsourcing going on, it will always stay in this guesstimate. And then in the interface, if you change the location, you will see that the actual trace would also will immediately adapt to that situation. So that's in 5 years' time where we went from the with OpenIP Map, now RIPE IP Map, from a prototype to the production thing. So then what Emil did was, he actually set out to see if local traffic would stay local, which was somewhat controversial at the time, because for lots of non-Nordic countries, we see actually like places like Belgium or Germany are extremely local. So there's almost no traffic in Germany that will leave Germany if it's destined for Germany. And the same holds true for Belgium. However, for Sweden, back then we saw that like, we saw these numbers, which, yeah, may or may not make sense. And these would be the kind of paths that we're seeing. There was some traffic going up to M6, some traffic going up to DKIX, and some traffic going up to Copenhagen. These would be, so yeah, he made it, I'll show the first, this would be the full matrix. So this is what it looked like back then. Basically, yellow and green is stuff stays within the country, and blue and red is stuff goes out of the country. We updated this scheme to look like this. We were pointed out that this is far too alarming to have this in red, basically, especially for Sweden. So we found out that if you rotate the diagram, it's easier to read the return paths and the, you know, from the A to B and B to A paths, because basically what this is, this means this are all the probes listed up here and here. So any crossing on this matrix represents one direction, which it should be right because internet is asymmetrical. But on the other hand, there is a relationship between going from A to B and B to A. So here you can sort of, here's a rough indication whether paths are sort of symmetrical in terms of locality of the traffic. So this stuff on a horizontal line is now, that should be somewhat coherent. And this is what it looks like now. Well, that's far better on the, so the brown stuff here, it goes out of country and not through an IXP, if I'm correct. Yeah. So that's almost gone. And the stuff that you see here is pretty interesting. They are anycasted. So that's pretty hard to figure out from a geolocation point of view. If you get like an anycasted, I think this was level 3. Still weird, by the way, why would you go through level 3 for local traffic from Sweden-based traffic, but hey. But it was an anycast IP address, so that would pop up on multiple locations, and then it becomes very hard to figure out which location that actually would be. We could only, if we did that from the basically context of the trace, we would say it's very unlikely that this thing actually goes to Russia. You know, it doesn't make sense. It probably stays within Stockholm, and the RTTs would also indicate that it's true. However, MPLS tunnels can also throw some sand into that analytical machine. But okay, so this is, if you compare it on the scale, this is 2015, it's 2019. You see that this stuff, so not going through an IXP but out of country, is roughly similar. And the thing is, if you look at the percentages, they're still the same. The only thing that's the real weird stuff going through an IXP and going out of a country, that is just errors, artifacts of our measurements. So yeah, for IPv6, back in 2015, we could not produce the matrices for IPv6. Also, they would be completely uninteresting because they would basically be an 8x8 matrix. But now it's much more comprehensive. However, there's much more brown in here. So it's interesting. What we have no clue why that happens. I couldn't go any dig. I could dig deeper into this analysis why this, but I have no clue right now. So another thing. Oh yeah, that was an interesting thing. In 2015, Emil tried to see if he would kick out Oslo and Copenhagen, what would be left of out-of-country stuff. And you see, like, that's very, very little over here. And right now, you see that's the same stuff. These are artifacts. This is the same stuff, any guessed artifacts. I only think there's, like, two or three routes in the totality of what is this, like, the 200x200 matrix that actually go out to M6 or something, which is probably a anomaly. The peer-to-peer fabric, very fast, because probably people want coffee now. This is a circle that's a full circle represents all of the AS's end users in a country. The open part of the circle actually indicates not data that we don't know, but ASs that provide less than 1% of the connectivity within that country. So that's also a measure of the sort of diversity of end user providers, basically. Then within the ring, you see the blue rings are transit providers that function within the country, and the orange ones are IXPs. And then these circles on the edges is the amount of trace routes that go or that start or go through this particular AS, and the size of the segment. This is one AS, and the size of the segment is the percentage of the end users that the AS represents. So, yeah. So here that's rehashed. Yeah, and then there are lines through the diagrams. So orange lines indicate these D2 ASs connect through an IXP, orange lines. And blue lines indicate that there's apparently a direct peering relation. So this is not BGP data at all. This is only trace route data. So we infer that this is direct stuff. And if it's a dotted line, then we know there's stuff in between. But we sort of figured when it's a direct peering that there's probably not IXPs of transits in between. There's just stuff in between. We don't know what. This could have been sharper. But this is basically what Sweden looks like in March 2019. So we run this stuff every month, like the rest of the IXP country JEDI. And it's a snapshot. So we don't do anything to aggregate the trace routes. It's one run, like one trace route from A to B, B to A. And that's it. So this is Sweden is remarkably stable. But there's countries that vary wildly over from month to month, and that might just be an artifact of the way we do it. But that having said, like this is Sweden is among the most stable. So what you can use, so typical picture for Sweden, I guess. I mean, there's some transit providers in between. So level three is third level three that with their Anycast net. I don't know what this is, but this is apparently a transit provider. Cogent isn't here, but for the rest, it all makes complete sense, right? These are you'll see NetNot Stockholm here four times. Those are the different peering lands apparently. So we get the data for all the peering lands from PeeringDB. Here you can see this also is somewhat correct. As far as I could see, mainly what I do if I go over to give a talk, I manually see if it makes sense. For some countries, this is really weird. But so the landscape in Sweden is like so. This part would be other ASs, but you can see that these are they cover probably more than 80% of the market. And other notable examples, like very typical things, is like Southern Korea. There is one IXP, by the way. You got a bit upset when they saw this. And we see them once in a while, but they sometimes drop off. This also this because it's a snapshot. Probably if we would properly aggregate, we would see more of them. But this is pretty typical of Southern Korea. So and then there's Ireland, which is sometimes these also disappear. They basically, I think 90% of the traffic goes to INEX. Apparently, that's also what they claim. So probably good. And then this is United States. Not also because it's very big, but you can see like transit providers play a much bigger role than IXPs do. So like, and then the biggest is Seattle. Yeah, it's six Seattle, which is basically probably the largest community IXP in the United States, but still only this little thing. So yeah, this is where you can play around with the country JEDIs. Especially with the peer-to-peer visualizations, there's a drop-down where you can an autocomplete where you can look up other countries. And I want to conclude with this kind of stuff that I every week I've been not doing this for quite a while, but I'll pick it up again. Is looking for weird trace routes in our system. And so this is a trace route that I like very much. It's the trace route that just cannot decide whether which way to take, like go to the left to the other side of the world or go to the right. So and once in a while, it swaps places. So that's it.
So we have time for a quick question or two for Jesper, otherwise we can go into the coffee break. Any questions? Okay. Thank you very much, Jesper. Yep.